sessions will be moderated in this room. So for our team and 20 talkers, I'll give you a 5-minute warning before your time is up. And I have a very special tool for those who go over time. we're going to have maybe like 10-minute questions or so after the team and 20 talks. In about 5 or 7 minute questions after the 2 minutes back talk. So I think we'll get started right away with you. If you want to introduce yourself, maybe.
My name is Michael. I'm a student in my first master's semester, and I'm today here to present you about the steering group, the scientific work group for rocketry and space flight at the University of Munich. I'm the student head of this group, and today I will show you at first something about our organization in general, just a short overview about it. And then we have different projects we are working on. Well, the presentation, it is quite big. It has 59 slides, so way too much for a conference, for a 20-minute talk. But I thought, yeah, it's an unconference, so I let you choose the topic of the presentation. well, we have rocket technology, which is all about hybrid rocket engines and rockets itself. Then we have space elevator, that's about a lot about bringing the space elevator into public and about competitions. Then interstellar space flight, about going to the next star system, and also quite interesting, and our newest project, satellite technology. So before we choose which topic we are talking about, but I have another idea what we could do. We could go just through all the videos. I think that would be 20 minutes. Okay, but let's start with the organization in the beginning. So, our student group is quite old already. We were founded in 1962 by the former student and now professor Robert Schmucker at the Technical University of Munich. In the beginning, they developed the first German hybrid rocket engine called Barbarella, and which you now can see at the German Museum in Munich. We are a student group and also an associated student group of the DGLR, the German Society for Aerospace. Our patron is Professor Ulrich Walter, the head of institute at the University of Munich for Aerospace. And we also cooperate with other chairs, for example, the chair of flight system dynamics and of propulsion systems. Here you can see our homepage, our address, and our Facebook. Please join us on Facebook, we always like it. Okay, then let's go on. Over the last years, the number of members had increased quite dramatically, I think. So we are at the moment 120 students. Without the first semester students in the bachelor, in the first bachelor, we are 110 to 120 students. This is also due to the different projects we have. We got new projects. Most of the projects are quite new, for example, space satellite technology, but I can come to that later. These students can be distributed to the projects. Therefore, we have the model rocket workshop, which is for the first semester students to learn how to build rockets. And then the biggest project is satellite technology with roughly 50 students working on it at the moment. And the smallest is interstellar space flight, but they are small, but they are very good students, and yeah, they know what they are doing. Okay, so the structure overall, we have a scientific supervisor, which is a PhD student at the chair of aerospace in Munich. And well, then we have also other resources which are typical for a student, which are typical and which we need. For example, financing and administration, the project leaders which manage the projects. And then we have also some things about education, especially for first semester students. But I will show you that with a few pictures. For example, every winter semester, so it starts now, we have a model rocket workshop where students in the first semester develop or build smaller rockets in order to learn how to work in a team and to get to know each other. This is always quite successful. Every year 30 to 50 students working on that. We also do some public relations stuff, for example presenting papers at the ISC. Here you can see two papers, one is the right is 3 years ago, and the left was at ISC this year in Naples. Furthermore, we are also at the Berlin Air Show, ELO, in Berlin every 2 years. On the right, it was 3 years ago as well, and the left was this year. It was quite cool because, as you can see in front, there is our newest rocket, which is currently under development and almost finished. I will come to that later again. Furthermore, we have, as I told you, we are quite old. We celebrated our 50th birthday 2 weeks ago with a lecture series and afterwards some dinner. It was quite fun and a lot of people from industry and visited this event. Okay, now we come to the more interesting things, the projects. Okay, so overall we have four, we call programs, project, rocket technology, space belt, and ISS, and satellite technology. So now it is up to you, what do you want? Do you want to hear something about rocket technology, or the space elevator, or ISF and satellite technology? I think this is small enough to put it into one. So what do you want?
Interstellar space flight.
Yes.
Space flight. Okay. Okay, then I go to space flight and just mention the other few projects. Just for a few minutes, seconds. That would be a cool video. I skipped that. Also a cool video. I skipped that. But let's go to the last video because this is very. This is the newest video for our propulsion group for rocket technology, which is the hot firing of the test of the propulsion system Hyper 1. It's working. So it was a test firing about 5 seconds with a. The thrust of 1,000 newtons. You see the thrust declines a bit. That's due to the pressure decrease in the tank system. But overall, it was quite quite successful. Okay, there's the rocket which you see here, which this engine is running in. The engine is running, which you have seen in the video, is running here in this rocket. Okay, that's it for. Rockets. Then I skip a bit further. Let's go to space elevator. I have to show you this because one of our group made an incredibly cool video, which I have to show you. And now we can go on to the part you want, which is Interstellar Space Flight. Okay. Okay. So, does anyone of you know what this is about? What this is? Yeah, exactly. Alpha Centauri. Correct. And when you think about the distances between our sun and Alpha Centauri, if we say that the sun to our Earth, the distance is 1 meter, then the distance between the Earth and Alpha Centauri would be approximately 230 kilometers. So quite a high distance. When we now think about how far we got out till now, the moon, we landed on the moon, and the moon would be in this scale 3 millimeters. And the farthest out a probe we developed, the Voyager, is 100 meters out. So when we think about interstellar space flight, there are distances which are extremely high, which are more or less not imaginable. You cannot imagine it. But there are a few concepts on how to get to these far distant star systems. For example, there's the world ship concept, which means to build a very, very big ship with a lot of people living in there, which flies at low speed to the next planet, for example, with 0.3 to 0.4 of the velocity of light. On the other hand, you could build a ship which is quite fast and which does not carry so many people, and which reaches the goal in maybe 100 years instead of 200 to 300 years. So these are the two major concepts which are existing at the moment. And in our student group, in this project, Interstellar Space Flight, we think about possible concepts and how to make it possible in an engineering way. Therefore, it was founded in 2009. At the moment, there are 4 members. And the vision of this group, of the team, is to be a worldwide leading think tank about manned interstellar space flight. Therefore, the mission is to publish high-quality papers for the scientific community and the public in general. On the right side, you see two pictures of a concept which is called the WARR, a concept 2 years ago, approximately, yes. But at the moment, we are working on a different, we are working still on this topic of interstellar space flight, but on a different project, which is called Hyperion. And Hyperion is a project, and it is a part of Icarus Interstellar as well. I'll come to that later. And during the next 2 years, the goal is to have a state-of-the-art study for a manned interstellar space flight, a spacecraft, which includes the domains of life support system, thermal system, and propulsion system, and so on. Thereby, we want to use 2 days in near future technologies, so no warp entry, for example, unfortunately, not possible. Not possible, that's not correct, but not very feasible. Yeah. Okay, and yeah, there are also the identification of technology development. So, I talked about Icarus Interstellar. Maybe some of you heard about it. It is also a group which was founded in 2009 and which is the remake of the Daedalus study. And it is from the British Interplanetary Society. And together and WARR ISF as a team cooperates with Icarus Interstellar in the Hyperion project, which is currently under study. Okay, so what is the current status? At first, they want to think about the question if interstellar space flight is possible with today and near future technologies. Therefore, they answer three fundamental questions at first. How can humans, how can human life be enabled and sustained in interstellar space flight? So they think about the spacecraft itself, but they also think about knowledge. So about how can knowledge be transferred and restored when it takes 200 years to get to the new planet? Because the knowledge is what defines our society, and then it does not make any sense if our society cannot survive this long to go when we go to the next planet. And then also quite important, how can long-term presence at the target star system can be established? Thereby we think about the size of the population of the planet that it now degenerates and these things. Okay, what is the motivation for interstellar space flight? Here are two things. At first, a lot of exoplanets are being discovered currently, and this trend will go on in the future, definitely. And maybe we find a planet which could be suitable to have life, which is suitable to live there. On the other hand, there's the Deiml paradox. It says that the universe is quite big, and with a lot of galaxies, with a lot of stars in it, and also a lot of planets. So it should be highly unlikely that there are no other living beings out there. But on the other hand, when you think about this, if there are any living beings out there, why aren't they come to us? So if maybe they evolved 10,000 years ago, they should have the means to get to our planet, or at least populate the galaxy, but they haven't. So this is a paradox. And when we think about interstellar space flight, we think about if it is possible to get out there. And if we investigate that it is possible to get out there, then the question is, why haven't they done that? So it is also thinking about the likability that there are people out there from that there are other human no not humans but there are other life out there in the universe. Okay, so that's so much for interstellar space flight. We can talk about it afterwards in the question if you are interested. Now just 1 minute or two, then I don't get the... let's talk about satellite technology, which is because we are building at the moment, we started 1 year ago to develop our own satellite, which is called Move-to-WARR. And therefore, Move-to-WARR stands for Munich In-Orbit Verification Experiment 2, WARR Antimatter Research Platform. So this name is quite long, and it has also a lot of content in it. At first, it would be the second satellite which is developed at the University of Munich. The first satellite is already finished in development, but unfortunately, the launch date is still not sure, because it is always delayed because of political issues or so. So we are building on the successor of this project. It will have as a payload an anti-proton detector, which should detect protons in the lower or in a lower Earth orbit. And therefore, we cooperate with the physics department at our university and with the chair of aerospace at our at our university as well. So this is the last project I wanted to show you. So if you have any questions, please ask them right now.
On the rocket you're pulling, which altitude are you aiming for?
About the rocket.
What rocket you are?
Okay, so the rocket I showed you, Device 2, which is that's the name of it, and it should reach 5 kilometers approximately. We are planning a new rocket, which should reach a height of 15 kilometers.
And this also part of the STEM program? Or
yeah, that would be part of the STEM program. Yeah, second. Yeah.
Who's your launcher for Move to Wrap?
We have none at the moment. So we are still in thinking about it, what would be possible. But in the end, it will be the launcher who is willing to take us and who has the right orbit, we will choose it. Okay.
Have you guys in your research of interstellar travel looked at the balance between sending something in the short term out to a star versus spending more time doing internal research so we can develop propulsion systems? Because I mean, the idea of passing them, a world ship on its way, passing them when they arrive before you get there.
Well, what we are doing is a theoretical study. It is not about doing it in a practical way to send something out there. It's really a study about what is necessary to build in 200 or 300 years such a star.
So, I mean, is that a topic that's addressed? Kind of the philosophy of sending something short term versus
but it is not certain at the moment. It is also the question: what do you sending? Are you sending just some real humans, or maybe some stem cells, which we, embryos was the right word, which were then born at the system, the star system. So there are a few possibilities. They look through all of them and think about the advantages and disadvantages. But at the moment, there's no trend to go.
Of course.
Okay.
Have you thought of any interstellar trips? Do you think of any specific technologies to reach the proper speeds that you mentioned?
They think about it. For example, laser sails, for example, or what else is quite interesting? Also about antimatter and matter reaction. But this is everything is quite complicated. And I think most of the studies at the moment about interstellar space flight are concentrated on the propulsion system. So, and we also want to think about the other parts of the system, which are also not that easy. Yes?
Earlier this month, it was World Space Week, and the theme was space for human security and safety. And I was wondering if you had any projects that you did that could contribute to the safety of human mankind, or security of humans.
Actually, we don't.
Or for example, or just an example, how could interstellar space flight help mankind in a way?
Okay.
Or how to improve mankind's daily activity?
How could it improve interstellar space flight? Well, that's a difficult question. I think it is about the curiosity to go to some planet else. And the standard argument is always, if the world gets too small for all of our humans, then it would be great to have another planet to go. But this is quite, the normal things you can say, but it's not so a good argument.
So would that be an idea that should we, say, in a couple of hundred years, want to move to another exoplanet? It would become possible?
Yeah, that's exactly the question we want to think about, if it is possible to get there. That's what we're doing in the study, thinking about the possibility to get there.
Okay, guys, we need to move on. Thank you, Richard. You still have time to ask a question during the talk, so.